Okay, I was under the 20-minute assumption as well, so I will try to move it along as quickly as possible. The genesis for what I wanted to speak to you about today comes out of, I work at a Catholic institution, and we've been in this process of trying to understand our own Catholic identity, our own heritage. Particularly, we were founded by a religious order, the Congregation of Holy Cross, and as fewer of those brothers and priests are around to live their charism, to demonstrate what it meant to be a Catholic and an academic, we've had, as lay people, we have the task of trying to figure out what that means, to take the place of these religious brothers and sisters and priests. And this process, I work in the interreligious areas within our ministry department, and I keep finding that the more I enter into interreligious dialogue, the more I am driven back to understanding and gaining an understanding of my own tradition. And I think that speaks well of what Gulan would advocate, that we come to an understanding of others and we come to an understanding of ourselves at the same time. So that's been the genesis of what I wanted to talk about. So I'd like to talk about two gentlemen, Fethullah Gulan, obviously, and then Father Basil Moreau, who is the founder of the Congregation of Holy Cross. He was a Roman Catholic priest in 19th century France. He founded a system of schools, most notably the University of Notre Dame in Indiana, probably the most famous of the schools, but started off with just small little elementary schools, 150 years ago. So I'll share a little bit about these two gentlemen. And hopefully from their experiences, we'll have some offerings on what we might do as far as proceeding in interreligious dialogue, what we can learn from these two gentlemen. So we have Father Basil Moreau, as I said, who entered into the world in 19th century France, right after the Reign of Terror and the French Revolution. France was in extreme turmoil. It had been a Catholic nation prior to the Revolution, but the Church was very much involved with the monarchy. But France was in difficult times. They had just gone through a 7 years war. They built elaborate palaces at Versailles, and they were in kind of financial straits. And they had a growing urban population and a growing peasantry that were asking for more demands upon the government that the government was unable to fulfill. And it was spiraling into debt, which ultimately led to this revolution. Plus, at the same time, you have individuals such as Voltaire and Locke, Rousseau, Montesquieu, offering a new understanding of social order, where they were questioning social hierarchies and raising the belief that no person should be subject to another person, that each person is equal, which are actually concepts that go back to Augustine and the Christian understanding that all people are created in the image of God, although they were not citing that connection at the time. And the democratic gospel of the French Revolution rested upon the glorification of man rather than God. And so there was this close tie between the church and the monarchy, which eventually led to very harsh retaliation by the revolutionaries against the Catholic Church of its time. The government, the National Assembly that came into power, nationalized church property, outlawed religious communities such as the Jesuits. Clergy were required to submit an oath to civil constitution or be deported or executed. Citizens were given religious freedom. France at that time was a Catholic nation. So this, again, went against the interests of the Catholic Church at the time. And during this Reign of Terror, a deist religion was declared in France, and Christianity was denounced as superstitious. The nationalization of church property greatly impacted the educational system of France, and this is what I find the most interesting when we talk about Gulan and Moreau and the educational system. France's school system was predominantly run by the church prior to the revolution. So in the wake of the revolution and basically the elimination of the influence of the church, there was a vacuum in the educational system. Most of the good majority of the teachers had been religious priests They were no longer able to operate unless they took an oath to the government. So you had, in the aftermath of the French Revolution, a deterioration of the educational system within France. So we have these two figures that were born in the aftermath of radical political transformations of their respective countries, in which the former government structures were large in line with religion, Catholicism in France, Islam in the Ottoman Empire. Both countries would succumb to democratic and revolutionary reforms in the aftermath of political and military structure. And while religion was discouraged, and in some cases even attacked, by secular-leaning governments, both these religions maintained a very strong presence within their respective countries, because they were embodied in the people, maybe not in the political systems, but they were embodied in the people, and within people's worship and lifestyles. As stated earlier, I want to talk about the education systems that have come out of as a result of these two gentlemen. In both countries, you had governments that seized the educational system and used it, at least for a period of time, to try to promote nationalism and to promote a new order, a new understanding that was more focused around human understanding as opposed to centrality of God. In France, Father Moreau, recognizing the growing liberalism that was very anti-Catholic, it was a system that rejected any sense of supernatural view of life. And it was guided by really belief that Christianity in particular was antiquated. It was a relic of the Dark Ages. It was obsolete. It was further believed in France that Catholicism was unable to progress due to a pre-scientific mentality that should be excluded from participation in education and culture. And Father Moreau would work against these kind of prevailing attitudes and against the state monopoly on education, viewing it as unjust, and trying to isolate the philosophic principles of the liberals. And he argued that this kind of secular understanding of education really fostered skepticism and pantheism. So he would, he sought to work against this, but he worked within the government structure. He did not try to start a dissident movement. He tried to gain approval for a new educational system within the French government and tried to gain full teaching rights for Holy Cross priests and brothers that were emerging. And I think this is a point that to remember when we talk about dialogue, that we work within existing systems. It's not always a confrontational. We have to respect those that we are in dialogue with. Also, what I found interesting about Moreau in comparison with Galland is he recognized that the importance of science, and that we have to accept science without prejudice and in a manner adapted to the needs of our time, quoting from Moreau. And this is at a time where you had a Catholic Church that was really withdrawing from the world and withdrawing from science. They were going into sort of a fortress mentality. They were very fearful of this Enlightenment period. So Moreau was found himself often caught between two worlds. He was often passed off to be a wild Democrat, almost a communist, a representative of the people, and then at other times, because he worked with the government structures, he was viewed by, as a royalist and teaching anti-Republican ideas. So he had to chart a middle ground between these two extremes, one that was very former monarchy, and now very, very liberal Republican leaning. And this is something I find also similar to in Galland's experience, so kind of taking a middle ground between the two extremes of religious expression. For Moreau, the purpose of education was to instill the values of the Christian faith. The light of the gospel will dispel the darkness of our times. Its morality will influence our manner of life, and justice will reign, quoting from Moreau. Moreau really promoted an active pedagogy. In his instruction to educators, written in 1856. He says, to what end would it serve the students to know how to read, write, calculate, and draw, or to possess some notion of history, geography, geometry, physics, and chemistry, if they were ignorant of their duties to God, to themselves, and to society, or if, while knowing them, they did not conform their conduct to that knowledge? It is up to you, then, to teach all that to your students and to get them to practice it as much as is in your power. Moreau did not advocate a retreat from modern studies or discovery, but questioned their relevance if they were not directed to the service of the common good. And they were oriented toward a Christian understanding of resurrection and an option for the future. Moreau recognized that out of his faith, that there was a future that we work towards and that we are asked to act. And that sounds familiar from what we've heard earlier about Galland and his teachings. The task, according to Moreau, was to prepare youth with all its lights and virtues to come to the aid of modern society, a society molded by revolutions, in addition to inculcating the law of duty and the principles of faith. We must provide the child's intelligence with all the instructions needed to pursue the different careers he may be called upon to follow. I think you hear Galland, very similar teachings that, you know, from the voice of Galland that we've heard earlier today. France was a country that was trying to recover out of conflict, and they needed a trained, educated populace, and which had been neglected for many years. I think Galland would inspire a similar but different movement. Unlike the Congregational Holy Cross, which is this formal body, those who adhere to the teachings of Galland have a less formal structure. You don't have a hierarchy, in a sense. And I think that can be advantageous at times. It allows you to, again, an important aspect of interfaith dialogue is you have to deal with the people that you're with in the room at the time. I'll put it that way. I can't worry about dialogue with people that are in California. You are who I'm with today. So that's who my context is for this morning. Galland, influenced, as we've heard, by the philosophy of Rumi, sought a life that seeks to live out shared aims in a larger social context. Galland's quick to point out that he has no schools, but that the schools embrace the educational vision of Galland are established by individual agreements, as we said. Two minutes. Okay. All right. I will share a few things then. In service of dialogue, I think the things that we can learn from these two men is that their life experiences. Basil Moreau grew up in 18th century France. He probably was not thinking about interreligious dialogue unless it was with French Protestants. But I think we do have things to learn from him. They both responded to the conditions that they encountered. And context is very important if we're going to act. We act within a particular context. And borrowing from a Catholic phrase, we respond to the signs of the times. They were not isolated in their respected worlds. Their faith and religion were not centered on an asceticism that secluded itself from the world, but was engaged in a lived context. Moreau and Galland entered in the world at the time, and they sought to marginalize religion. They entered a world that sought to marginalize religious expression as irrelevant. In our current discourse, I think we have kind of the other end of the spectrum, a religious extremism, such as Christian fundamentalism and Islamic extremists, that frames the world on the other end of the religious continuum, caught up in this hyper-expression of religious rhetoric and action that, in my mind, is isolationist, and it separates religion out from people and from each other. Both men understood the need to chart a course somewhere in the middle between extreme asceticism and extreme expression. And I think their school systems fostered such an approach, not teaching dogmatic understanding, but teaching universal values and letting the lived expression, in a sense, witness to the understanding of God. they worked within their prevailing authorities, structures, wherever they were at. They worked with the local government, whatever the conditions that existed at the time. Truth for both men was something that stood apart. Truth, in my understanding, is a manifestation from God. Truth is not created by humanity, but God uses humanity to reveal truth. And in the work of dialogue, we must be open to such a truth, particularly a truth that's not evident to us in our own understanding. Both Moreau and Galen demonstrated this in their approach to the sciences, which was not, in their mind, viewed as a threat to the existence of God, but as a revealing of God within the creation, which I think addresses the gentleman's earlier question. So for the purpose of dialogue, such an understanding eliminates the entanglement that needing to be right, a focus of so much of the political and religious discourse today. We can eliminate that. If we were just open to truth, we don't have to, our identity is not centered on our point being correct, whether it is or not. Interreligious dialogue must be practical. Most people on the street do not have the time or the resources to engage in dogmatic debates and ascetic seclusion and discussions. They live in a world of their own context, usually focused on economic survival for their families, leaving little time for the subtle nuances of dogmatic discussions and theology. Both Moreau and Galen responded to such situations. They recognized people that were in particular need. They were not caught up in the goal of trying to flesh out correct dogma. They recognized the universal understanding of God in the different faiths and tried to respond to the needs of people where they were at. We must choose in our approach to interreligious dialogue what questions we will be willing to grapple with. Will we take a similar route? We have a smaller world, as Galen says. One of the consequences of creating a global village is interreligious dialogue is not a luxury but a necessity. We don't live in a world where you can go through your whole lifetime and perhaps never meet somebody from another religious tradition. It's virtually impossible. So it's a necessity. All right. Thank you.